Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to this last session of domestic TV workshop. We have a galaxy of speakers for this panel discussion, an interactive panel discussion. We'll touch upon various aspects of domestic TV. Some of them may have been discussed during the course of the day. Let me introduce our panelists. On my extreme right, I have Mr. Samir Gandhi. Samir Gandhi heads the transpricing practice of Deloitte. He is based in Bombay. On my right, I have Ms. Pinky Mehta. She heads the tax at Aditya Birla Group. On my left, I have Mr. Khaitan. Mr. Khaitan heads the tax team at Lupin Pharmaceuticals. He is based in Mumbai. We have Manisha. Manisha is a partner and director with Deloitte. All these professionals have extensive experience on tax and specifically the subject of transpricing. And I've been interacting with most of them since this law was introduced. And over the last 1 year, the thoughts have evolved, isn't it? Let me start with Ms. Mehta. Your group has several entities, several transactions. How did you prepare yourself, and how are you sort of approaching the November 30th deadline?
In case of one group, what we did, that since is, though it is applicable for the financial year 12-13, we did the full documentations for the financial year 11. We did the full documentations for the financial 11-12, and we tried to benchmark as far as possible the major expenditures and all these things, and if there was a need for to relook at the transactions and all these things were done, so which helped us. In fact, when I shared my thoughts with the group company, everybody said this is a smooth sailing for us, because this is, for us it's a second innings, it is not a first inning. Most of the things were already much done before for the previous year.
Right, Mr. Khaitan, how's management in your company sort of looking at this new compliance, and how did you prepare yourself for this new compliance, so to speak?
To be very honest, I do not know about the management, how the management is perceiving this. They are thinking this is an additional requirement with additional burden and additional cost. But when this provision was introduced way back, say in April 2012 or before that, when the budget came, we started preparing ourselves. So we have substantial captive consumption. So we have API, that is active pharma ingredients, which are used then in formulations, and the formulations are used for treatment of patients. So we have been actually, I would say that we are prepared not from this year. We have been doing this benchmarking since we enjoyed tax holidays under Section 80I, 80HH, and then 80I, then 80IB, and then 80IB, and then 10B, and now 10AA. And fortunately enough, in spite of our investigations and audits, we have never faced any adjustment on account of cost allocations and captive transfers. So we have been doing the benchmarking of the transaction, and I don't think there is much change. The law has changed, gone through a radical change. Earlier the concept was fair market value or the market value. Now it has been substituted by arm's length price. So there is not much. I would rather say it is, both the terms are coterminous or synonyms.
That's quite interesting to know. Samir bhai, you interact with so many promoters, companies. How are they looking at this? And from a consulting fraternity, what is the challenge that you've seen clients are facing in the implementation of this law?
Right, Amya. I think I will say the results or the experiences were mixed. So some are, like Pinky and Khaitan mentioned, are doing things in advance, getting prepared, but which is good.
Right.
But as I said, results were mixed. So some cases we did hear that what's new, And I mean, just echoing Kaitan on that point, I mean, it's like 410(2)(b) and tax holidays are always there. Sections were always there. I was discussing either in tax audit report or tax holiday certificate. So nothing has changed. So why you are kind of hurrying and, you know, typical coming out with consultants' viewpoints and getting us unnecessarily worried. But I think one needs to be a bit, I won't say worried, but needs to be well prepared, because though it was, the sections were always there, now we know it will be scrutinized by transfer pricing officer, all SDT transactions, and it will have some more focused, increased focus, I will say, Amaya, on the same transaction. So I will, of course, hope that, for example, tax holidays positions which AO has accepted will continue, but we need to wait and see next 3 years. Like, for example, if I get one more minute there, Maya, for say captive power plants, which many of us have.
Right.
Now, easier way was there, 2-3 things which were in dispute was on, say, first on the sale price, I mean, on the which I sell my power to captive unit, to the manufacturing site, production units. And we normally used to take the grid price, whatever state electricity board charges to third party customers, including me, for example. But now, if you apply, which is fine and normally it's accepted, and we know there are many case laws also to that impact, but to accepting that proposition. Now, if we come back to transfer pricing, now if I start with, say, typical functional analysis, then my captive power plant is a generating company. Whereas in state electricity board, we have a generating company, we have a transmission company, we have a distribution company. Ultimately, the price distribution company sells to the final consumer. So if I just go by a typical functional analysis, how we do, then I'm not comparing like to like. The grid price can't be the price for my captive power sell to my production unit. So, you know, I think things will have to change, and it's, I will say, not yet all settled as we hope to be.
Sure.
Sure. Just to supplement over here, you know, sir, your question, you know, you asked was, what was the challenges which we as practitioners, we saw that our taxpayers were facing? So I think the first key challenge which, you know, dealing with taxpayers I saw was in identification of the transaction itself. You know, the law will evolve as it's evolved in the case of international transfer pricing. And there's very little, you know, there is no judicial precedent and very little administrative guidelines as well. So even in a case of, you know, direct or indirect shareholding, there has been a lot of debate. Now there seems to be some kind of you know, approach which is being taken consistently across practitioners that we're looking at direct shareholding, but a number of other issues. It's still grey, and as you saw, a lot of speakers, you know, throughout the day talked about two views. So I think key challenge firstly was identification, some of it, you know, based on the interpretation of the law, some of it the practical challenge itself in terms of how does one identify under 48(2)(b) perhaps, you know, payments which are made to directors' relatives who have, you know, a 20% or more in companies. So I think that was the first key challenge. The second one, as Sameer mentioned then, was in the case of related party transactions, was, you know, looking at it from an international transfer pricing, looking at the documents, looking at the characterization. Typically, so much thought hadn't gone into these kind of transactions. How do you characterize the entity? Who bears the risks? Who undertakes what functions? And therefore, what should be the pricing?
Right. Manish, I'm just stepping back, you know, 2-3 years back, before the domestic TP was introduced, we had situations where on the international transfer pricing side, tax holiday units earning, reporting profit margins more than what comparables were reporting. And you know, you were happy that you sailed through the international transfer pricing assessment, but then the bogey of ATI 810 sort of was sort of raised. Now that the domestic TP is also there, you know, you potentially have to balance both sides. Is it a situation wherein, you know, is it a situation like till you win head, I lose. Does anything change after the domestic TP has come?
See, if you're specifically asking in relation to ATIA 10 itself, the arm's length, it's true, you know, in the past few years for international transfer pricing, where the profit was higher than the arm's length pricing, the authorities were disallowing the tax holiday for such units, but there were a number of tribunal judgments which upheld that arm's length price is not equal to ordinary profits, more than ordinary profits. So that now has been changed under ATIA 10 insofar as specified domestic transactions have been concerned, and they put in the words arm's length pricing. Now again on that, now the onus has shifted from the tax authorities to the taxpayer to demonstrate that any transaction with parties who are closely connected is at arm's length basis.
Right. Sameer bhai, would you like to add anything on this?
Yeah, so your concern is quite valid, Amaya. And before even SDT, we know at least in outsourcing centers in Bangalore and Hyderabad and to some extent in Chennai, department did invoke for say tax holidays under 10A, where say the taxpayer was earning say cost plus 15, just taking an example, and comparable says cost plus 10. So international TP was you are fine.
Yeah.
But then ETI 10 of course is being referred in 10A or 10AA or 10B as the case may be. And so TPO determined arm's length price is fine. Then as it happens, he's given a caveat in this order, draft the TPO order 92CA, that AO may examine applicability of excess profit or ATI 10 profit, and AO as it happens did say, you know, 5% is excess. So there was no adjustment on transfer pricing under 92C, but there was adjustment applying ATI 10 vis-a-vis 10A. And we did win, taxpayers did win such cases before tribunal. Some of the cases argued by Mr. Dastur also, and he very rightly explained that ATI 10, if you read, it's more than ordinary profits. So,
yeah.
Which is not just because I am more than arm's length price doesn't mean I produce more than ordinary profits.
Sure.
And he has very, I will say, good analysis he has argued, and members in fact reproduced. Well, I think visual graphics case.
Right.
And other things also ETI 10, I mean, we have to see how things develop, but while they did amend arm's length price, still AO is required or department is required to establish, I think, that business is so arranged.
Right.
So there is still, that section has, I mean, that has not gone. So there has to be a arrangement, there is a arrangement, or I would say some way of clearly giving more profits to the unit.
Right.
So I think apart from the cases which we discussed on tribunal, I think this point also we should keep in mind.
Yeah, but maybe partly with the domestic TP specifically coming in, it gets watered down, perhaps at least proving the arrangement, you still have to do the compliance of benchmarking.
Right. So you're right, Amaya. So let me correct. So while complying, you have to do.
Right.
In case AO or TPO comes back with this excess profit, then you have to. You can argue this point as well.
Right. Moving on specifically to some of the transactions which are hit by this domestic TP legislation, and director's remuneration, as I mentioned, is one of the most talked about transactions. Mr. Khaitan, what are the possible approaches to sort of benchmark this transaction?
So one way is that the same audit committee is one of the way of looking, and I'm just don't remember the whole thing, I've written down a piece of the paper. Now, you see, the CUP method is very difficult to apply in this case. So, one is that because it board this personal remuneration, manager personal remuneration depends on host of factors, that is the experience, qualification, the industry experience, and then two directors cannot be compared similarly. That has been held by Delhi's High Court in High. So in this case, one, the benchmarking can be done that you do the TNM method at the entity level, and then benchmark, yes, this is, I have earned so much of profits vis-a-vis the remuneration paid by other companies to their directors. So my profits. Second is that since it has been approved by the audit committee, it is in accordance with the Schedule 13, Section 349, that is computation provisions 349 and 350 read with 309. So once it is approved, then there are host of decisions in the past rendered by various judicial authorities, like the Sriram Pistons 181 ITR Delhi, Honda Seal. So in those cases, it has been held that once the one arm of the government approves one transaction, then the other arm of the government cannot say that the transaction is not at all.
Okay.
So this can, that there could be other way of, you can draw the analogy of payment of royalty, again that has been now overruled once it is approved by RBI. Or so I would say best way is to benchmark the TNM method, because replacement cost theory or getting the quotations from the headhunters are not practical or feasible options.
Right. Madam, in your group or based on your experience, what could be the approaches on this transaction?
See, for directors' remuneration, basically, I would like to supplement what Mr. Khetan said, that benchmarking is very difficult in the sense that qualifications, their skill sets, their functional capabilities in which they experience, their experience, and all these things is quite different. So it is very difficult, to benchmark one director's remunerations with the other. And the thing is that this audit committee, the audit committee already approves. We have a remuneration committee which approves the director's remuneration. And if it is within the Companies Act limit, then I think that is the best benchmark we can do. And even as it is shared by Mr. Samir Gandhi, that in the yesterday associate meeting also, or you met somebody from the department where they said that the department itself is finding it difficult, that I think they will be coming out with some clarifications at how the director's remunerations will be benchmarked by the industry. So maybe we may hear any good news from them if good thoughts prevails on them.
Right. Before I take Manisha's comment, I also request our audience to raise any questions or any points during the panel. We can take some of the questions during the panel discussion. Manisha, your thoughts on...
Just want to give a reminder here that the moment we take into the consideration this is approved by the auditor's remuneration committee, audit remuneration committee, or it is within the parameters of the company law. So now there are two decisions, recent decisions of Mumbai Tribunal, where in they have said these are the upper limit prescribed under the relevant laws. So these are the upper ceilings. So this can be applied whether you cannot go beyond that, but this cannot, you can say that this is at arm's length. So basically is where you go, but just go at what is the profit earned by the company vis-a-vis the other companies, that would be the best.
No, I don't agree with you for that. Profit earnings cannot be, because then you need to look at, means you will hike the director's remunerations only when the companies are, that can be one of the criteria to look into, okay, if the company is on the growth path, okay, I have raised the director's remuneration.
What about loss making companies?
Yeah, exactly.
Yes, it means you will not pay anything to them.
Right.
Anybody in the audience who is holding position of director?
The thing is that in loss making companies, now section 198 of the Companies Act, I do not know the new section, that lays some parameters, but you cannot go beyond that.
Right. Can we have...
But then also it cannot be an arm's length, right? If it is the same way, if an upper limit is set up for the profit-making companies, the lower limit is set up for this, it cannot be set to be an arm's length.
I think perhaps there's no ideal answer. Manisha, any additional thought? And maybe we'll hear some of the directors, how they are looking at benchmarking in their companies.
Sure. So I think we should hear them first and...
Purnima, any thought on how your company is looking at benchmarking your remuneration?
No. That's fine.
Sure.
I'll try to talk. I think this is a little bit of a challenging situation, that how do we really get a benchmark done? Can I actually ask a kind of a survey like Mercer survey or something like that to find out if the company with this type of parameters, with this type of, you know, kind of responsibility structure, what should be the kind of remuneration, because it's always a combination of two things. You are holding a director as a position and also you are functionally responsible for something. And how do you kind of split that? Yeah. So maybe the Mercer survey can help us in defining what should be kind of the remuneration for the duties, you know, as an employee. And then what should be really attached to that as a director, you know. So that is definitely going to be as a gray area. And then I was kind of just thinking in my mind that yes, the company law has these prescribed provisions, but that kind of goes as a safe harbor rule, you know. It's kind of okay if that's the limit that you have. So
right.
I do not know whether we should really consider that as a arm's length. So that's a right. Really gray area.
I saw one more hand at the back. You would like to add anything on this perspective? No, see, somebody raised a hand as a director, and maybe we can come back to you, sir, after that.
I'm holding the director position, but not as a whole-time director.
Okay. Sir, you would like to add anything? Sorry?
Government officer, the Delhi government is going to come to become director. If you see in history, just between 1 lakh rupees per month. The valuation will come only 12 lakh, but he may otherwise pay 50 lakhs.
Okay. Just for the benefit.
Because judge did not pay even 1 day's argument fees.
Right.
And when after Jari judge, he becomes consultant, and he goes to a company.
Right. So perhaps so previous.
Individual into individual. Both individuals are similar, there cannot
sure.
be comparability.
Sure, sure. Moving on to the next critical transaction, you would like to add, Mr. Mithun?
I think Manisha wanted to add on this.
On this director's remuneration itself, if we look at Circular 6P, which was explaining the provisions of the introduction of 48 to, in 1968, over there it was clearly mentioned that in the finance minister, when introducing this provision of 48.2, had clearly specified that any limits which are prescribed under Companies Act so that would be considered. So therefore, I think using that for public companies, still we can rely on Schedule 13 and the limits which are prescribed there. Until, you know, as Samir mentioned, hopefully some guidance will be issued by the CPDT. But I think the practical challenge which we are facing is in the case of private companies.
Yeah.
As to, you know, there we don't, you know, have anything to fall back on. So in that case, until such time as we get this guidance, what we are doing currently is looking at the qualifications, you know, trying to document rather the qualifications of the directors, the kind of work they are doing, the services they are doing for the company in the prior, etc., to demonstrate that, you know, there was a benefit received by the company during the prior year for which they paid. In terms of benchmarking per se, it is difficult to benchmark unless you go to, you know, one of the HR firms like a Mercer, etc., and get a comparable.
Last comment on this point,
sure,
and then
sure.
We can move.
Yeah,
yeah.
That's right. On Mercer and I mean HR consultants, and we did think that maybe I think I will say technically very correct way, but practically we thought and we then decided not to follow that, because then we are giving to TPO officers kind of from where he will start. So as Manisha was mentioning, we can document even for unlisted company. What are the duties, what contributions the director is making, and then leave it TPO to come back with his position why it is not at arm's length. Here, otherwise, we are giving him comparables and it is easy to then bisect, dissect them.
Right, right.
Samir, my one question. We cannot emphasize too much on the qualification, because in sometimes experience counts more than the qualification. Even a fourth standard, or like I would say that like Apple, Steve Jobs, and those school dropouts have changed the fortune for their company.
Sure. There are more questions than answers on this point at the moment. Hopefully, CBDT will bring some clarity. The next key area which gets impacted by SDT is the allocation of common costs. You know, whether it is service, not service, whether allocation required, not required. There are a lot of issues around it. Samir bhai, let me start with you. You know, how does a corporate look at cost allocation specifically? And I'm talking about inter-unit cost allocation for the moment, and then we'll look at the cost allocation within different group entities. Cost allocation between different units of the business, some of them could be tax holiday units, some of them could be tax paying units. How should one approach the allocation methodology, or how should one approach cost allocation under SDT?
Right, so I think at least cost allocation is being done today also.
Sure.
While we discussed tax holidays earlier, the department did not question much on the price or sale price in the example which I was taking on captive power plant, but allocation is an issue which they hope like raising for some time now. Now, I will again put it not as a consultant, but practically also one can't rule down and in a way make, say, 10 rules to have specific allocation. It may vary from each case to case,
right.
facts of each case. But normal allocation will come on normally on management charge, which normally, as a rule of thumb, we do allocate on basis of sales, normally. The rule of thumb, and then if it's interest, it's obviously you can link with the funds deployed, so that should not be difficult. Many times those IT cost is on the number of human resource which is there, which is the software or IT help desk, so on and so forth. So some piece of, I will say, our cost accounting knowledge, which was always a difficult paper in C exam and still it is, that where I will.
I would ask Manisha to comment on this point. Is the cost allocation necessary? If yes, how should one go about doing it? I think one point which is critical in this, which comes to my mind, is whether markup is also required to be charged while doing this allocation.
Again, not black and white. There's a lot of debate on this. Specifically because of the wordings of the provision of 80IA8 itself, where it talks about where any goods held for the purpose of the eligible business, where any goods or services held. Now, what is services? Is it, you know, marketable services? Or is it, you know, say a group HR or a tax or a finance function service which is provided? So, I think the debate starts from there as to whether this is covered under 80IA8. There is a view which is taken that when the earlier 80IA8 included the words only goods, somewhere in 2001 services was also introduced, and the circular explaining the introduction of this mention talked about marketable securities. That's where the debate arises from. Having said that, as Samir mentioned, cost allocation has always been made. Now, the other point of view is that this cost allocation is therefore covered under 80IA5. Now, 80IA5 talks about the fact that this every unit, the profitability has to be computed as if it's the only source of income. And therefore, this cost allocation has to be made by the headquarters, and therefore it's covered under 80IA5 and not under 80IA8. Having said that, again, as you heard speakers throughout the day, this is an evolving topic. All these interpretations, all these positions, all these judicial proceedings all relate to the year prior to 12/13. And the way we are looking at it, when we're looking at two views, is when you look at section 92BA and read the definition of specified domestic transactions, And then you go to section 92 D and E, wherein they talk about every person who has entered into a specified domestic transaction needs to look at the documentation or the form 3CV. One view is that it needs to be read D-horse 92 2A. And therefore, your penalty provisions under 271 AA kicks in. Now, if one has to take that interpretation, then, you know, the caution has to be exercised in terms of reporting all these cost allocations also under ATIA.
But Manisha, the point is, one is whether cost allocation needs to be done or not. Assuming it needs to be done, and that seems to be more of a practical view, whether markup is necessary. So how should one decide that whether markup is necessary? And then of course the benchmarking is there. But let's for example, CEO salary. Is there any markup required when it gets allocated to different units?
See, on the CEO salary itself, there's a recent Hyderabad tribunal judgment of Cadila Healthcare, where the managerial remuneration need not be allocated itself. That, you know, that decision held that. But having said that, in
But that was before SDT.
That's what I said. So sure, that was under ATI 5. So if we have to look at the position that it has to be allocated, then one can differentiate between these marketable services and in terms of these common headquarter kind of charges which are levied. So in these kind of common headquarter charges, it would be appropriate to charge them on a cost basis. Whereas if it's a marketable services, it would be more useful to charge them on a mark.
Right. Madam, your experiences on the cost allocation?
Manisha, that pure administrative or common expenses needs to be on the basis of either on the basis of a turnover and all this, but any expense which is in a, which protects the character of a service by HO to the eligible units and all, then it should be on the mark.
For example, IT support system, IT support group.
IT support, but that also I don't think that it, usually we take it from an outside. The HO is not competent enough to give such type of service. So it may be only a cost allocation type of it.
Mr. Khaitan, any perspective on this?
I think this has been adequately covered, and there is no actually as such guidance. So one can go into the OECD and UN model articles. This is 7, wherein they have clarified that this kind of services are general in nature, general managerial services. Or one can put forward the argument these are shareholder services, so there is no markup necessary. Yes, cost allocation has to be done according to me, whether despite SDT has come or not, it was to be done. But then there were litigations happening because why you don't want to allocate, then you have to keep the nexus that this has got no nexus, then you have to scientifically prove and lot of documentation still you they are required to do. Now what has happened that rather than you preparing or the AO asking for all these things, you are giving everything ready-made to him,
right,
and then he will raise all the issues based on that report.
Okay. Anybody in the audience is exploring this position that cost allocation within units is not to be done?
This is not a view not to be done. It is more like how can we really prove? Because I think the principle actually remains the same whether it is an international cost allocation or a domestic allocation. And the benefit test needs to be passed. And if we actually have a proper background to really suggest that yes, although it is coming from the head office, but we can actually indicate or prove that there is a benefit, because if the similar things is to be kind of done at the individual company level, then maybe the cost that they need to really incur to get that particular things done is will be much higher. So it could be administrative service as well as it could be kind of HO type, because when we say it is a shareholder service, then also there is a specific thing that we can actually establish that what is it that we are actually, you know, getting done. It
right.
might be in terms of flow of information, it might be management reporting, it might be, you know, it could be in any different form, and I think that could be kind of proof. And if we can prove that, then probably it should be easier, you know.
Sure. Anybody who's explored the view that allocation within units not to be done? So there seems to be consensus at least on this point, on this hypotechnical position. If
I can just one add on this issue, there is only one area which looks very safe is research and development costs. So supposing you have a unit only catering to the domestic market and then you have set up one SEZ unit which is export oriented and then you are doing the research, incurring development costs for the domestic, then you need not allocate. But if you are the same way, will vice versa it will go. If you are incurring costs which are to be for export, then the entire thing will be loaded there.
Right.
So one has to take a view call whether you allocate proportionately in both the units,
right,
or you take 1 year you are in advantageous position, second year you lose out everything.
Right, yeah.
Kaitan is right, and just taking a cue from there, one is the R&D cost, other for especially for FMCG and pharma industry, the distribution cost is very high.
Right.
Advertising, marketing, promotion cost. And as we were, I think, discussing sometime back, many units are in, say, Baddi or Himachal Pradesh on a tax holiday. So there, the AMP cost or distribution cost is normally in corporate level.
Right.
They are not kind of, in that period it doesn't come. But of course, sale price is the full price which I sell to, say, final consumer. So I think department will be very closely examining not just cost allocation. They now move more to, you know, this AMP. And I think if you see principally, they may be right, why not?
Yeah. Marketing and intangible adjustment.
So, I just want to add my own thing. We do have a unit in Jammu and then we have other units in domestic and like Goa. So we were allocating the entire distribution and marketing costs in proportion to the turnover of that unit divided by the total turnover of the company. And second thing is that why I'm saying that the cost auditors are also required to prepare the report and do the cost allocation. So if you take one view for the cost audit purpose and the other view for the tax returns, then one is going to surely land in trouble.
Right. On cost audit, since you raised an interesting point, and Samir bhai would like to have your thoughts. I think last year there was a very interesting change in the way the cost audit reports are filed. You know, they also talk about arm's length principle. So how, and also the some of the new guidance which is issued on reporting of the costs itself is also will have an interesting dimension when it comes to the domestic TP. Would you like to touch upon this, how in fact cost accounting principles, guidance, law can be used effectively for domestic TP?
So I think you're right, Oman. As Kaitan mentioned, I think first of all we have to be a bit consistent, importantly.
Sure.
Plus some of the good way of allocations we can now find out from cost audit report, which are now mandatory, I think, from last year. And so far we have just filed, say, annexures and some mentioning of the methods. But if we go in detail, I think cost audit or even, as I said, cost accounting knowledge will be of good help to us
right.
as going further. And just on cost audit report, you mentioned, and it reminds me, as I said earlier, Amaya, we have normal report still continues for tax holidays, which we used to file.
Sure.
And now we have Form 3CP disclosure, and we have to be ensure that we remain consistent.
Sure.
Those unless it should not say something which is quite, I will say, and vice versa.
And right. Now you have to maternally, earlier there were decisions prior to this ATIB or ATI new section, whether you require maintenance of separate accounts. Now Supreme Court has laid this position, this debate at rest. Earlier it was not required, Bangaigaon was the decision, and then Asugan some 348 ITR, now they have said no. You
okay.
have to come in order to claim Chapter 6 deductions or 10A, 10B, you have to statutorily get the accounts prepared and audited. So, that is one area there where you have to absorb the, because auditor has to satisfy and see whether the allocation is made or not.
Right. I think moving on, another major area which, you know, probably could impact a lot of Indian group companies is on the funding side. And funding in the form of mainly the loan funding, you know, actual loans as well as a guarantee. I think there could be some serious domestic TP implication. Manisha, would you like to share some perspective on loan transactions and then guarantees, and then we'll have Madam's comments as well.
So if you have to look at loans and guarantee position, it's not covered because we are looking at only any unreasonable or excessive expenditure. Similarly, if no guarantee fee is paid. Where such an interest or guarantee has been paid, then the onus will be on the taxpayer to prove that it's not excessive. Another interesting scenario could be in the case of a tax holiday unit, wherein one of the closely connected companies could advance an interest-free loan to this tax holiday unit. So the question here is, can the tax authorities allege that because the tax holiday unit has not paid this interest or guarantee fee, it has resulted in more than ordinary profits? So subject to, you know, other conditions be fulfilled, that it's closely connected, it does give rise to a position in that case that it could result in a scenario where it results in more than ordinary profits.
Right. Yeah, I mean, Madam, your perspective on this?
Yeah. In fact, I would like to ask Manisha one thing, that in 40A2B, only the expenditure is covered, not the income part of it. So look at the situations where I have not paid anything, then how it will be reflected in the STD?
Exactly, so it's not going to be reflected because I'm looking at only the expenditure
part.
Yes.
Had it been the income is also covered in the STD, then the question would have come that why are not charged?
Absolutely.
It.
Yeah.
Right. But so, Manisha, on this point, if a tax holder unit has received some kind of a financial support, be it loan or guarantee, or let me put it the other way, if a tax holder unit has issued a loan or given a guarantee and they have not received any compensation for that from the entity, do you think SDT will apply? I'm looking at a 80-IA-10 type of a situation.
So, the wordings again we have to look at, it talks about in the course of business. So, it results in more than ordinary profits in the course of business. So my interpretation would be in the course of business is very wide to even include transactions like this where it's given a loan or an interest.
Right.
In the ordinary course of its, in the course of its business. And so perhaps even those should be included.
Right. Mr. Gandhi, your comment.
That point, so while normal, but all tax holidays has income has to be attributed or derived from that undertaking.
Yeah, that is what I was going to say.
So department is always position is that interest or financial charge is not a income from that undertaking. So though I might not charge, here you won't add it because it's not eligible for
exemption. Mr. Khaitan, any additional?
That is what I was saying, that Supreme Court in N number now from Sterling Foods to Liberty India has said first the income should be derived from the undertaking. So interest is not an income derived from the undertaking. It is, it has got no direct and proximate relationship with the manufacturing activity. So this income is springing from the money lending or some activities. So if it is not qualifying the deduction under 80IA, then there is no need to go into the technicalities that whether it is covered or
right.
not.
I thought on that point, and I mean this is a question, and we are so in same way, while interest is not derived from undertaking, can I not then if department should not come and say why you are debiting interest? I mean in the earlier case which
Samir, yes, you remember last year when this SDT lot of seminars were happening, so I raised this issue to various panelists. Say that Supreme Court now the attributed to is gone in relation to which is there in section 14A doesn't find place in a TIA or section 92. So one was that if I take the reverse view that income is derived the same way, why should not I interpret that the expenditure which has no proximate relationship with the undertaking, they should not be allocated at all. And I am saying, despite the SDTT provisions, still, any expense which has no remote connection, then it should not be like if I am taking loans for my non-taxable units, with the rider that I am not diverting them for my taxable tax holiday units, then I need not allocate the interest expense.
Right. Samir bhai, a quick question. You have share issue adjustment, which are adjustments being talked about, and in some of the earlier sessions we saw whether reporting needs to be done under domestic TP for such transaction. Do you believe there is a risk even in the domestic TP for similar adjustments?
I think the way, interest TP, as they say, the final, we have not heard final views.
Sure.
And
so that's why I said risk. Right. So,
but no, I think as far as disclosure part is that, though it's a very, I will say, technical or maybe we can say hyper-technical view, but the way Section 92BA is worded, it says any expenditure in respect of which payment is made to person specified in 4-type. So it doesn't say expenditure referred to in 4-type. So I go to 5-type just to identify the persons
right
for which I have made the payment. I mean, I have expended. And expenditure is a very wide term, and Kaitan will maybe supplement with some cases, but expenditure does not mean just revenue expenditure.
Okay.
It's like amount expended or goes out of my pocket.
Okay.
So just on your point query, even if I have purchased shares for my related party, I think my suggestion would be that we do disclose. As I said, maybe looks like hyper-technical, but I don't think it's wrong.
Okay. Manisha, would you like to add anything over here?
My views will obviously be similar, being Mr. Khaitan answer.
You see, the thing is that it speaks of the expenditure. Now, while computing my income under the head profits and gains of the business, Section 28 to Section 44 will come. I'm going into the technicalities rather than touching this transfer pricing. Share capital or share premium, has always been held that they are on capital account. They are not even capital expenditure. Now, what is expenditure and what is loss? And if you see in the context of Section 14A also, dividend, when you compute income, money taxable, you allocate the expenses. Now the issue was whether depreciation should also be allocated or not. Now, Supreme Court in Nectar's case, Nectar Beverages case, that is 314, ITR 314, has said that depreciation is not an expenditure, it is an allowance. So it is a capital expenditure. And if you see the circular 6P, when 40A was introduced way back in 1968, that circular is there, that says it has to be only revenue items are to be covered and capital expenditure is not to be touched with. So that being the benevolent circular that has to be applied, yes, that circular also speaks of direct or indirect shareholding. Leave apart that, then that benefit will still be available to me. And capital expenditure, yes, there could be, now there could be capital expenditure like in the case of Section 35,
right,
research, those kind of things will get covered, but not depreciation, I would say, certainly not covered.
Manisha, last comment on this point, and then we'll get some reactions from audience as well.
So I think the position here, Mr. Khaitan, is that, as Samir mentioned, when we're looking at 92BA and looking at persons who are covered, it's only for persons who are covered we're going back to 48.
Yes, supposing even if you are holding the shares now, shares, if under which section you will tax me?
Sure.
Section 56 is the only section.
That's a million-dollar question, which is before Bombay High Court. Hopefully, we'll get some answer in coming weeks. Any reactions from audience on reporting capital transactions? Can you use the mic, sir, please, so that...
Companies Act 372, Capital A 3 provides the minimum bank rate will be the rate every loan can be given. Still, interest-free loans are being given in violation of debt.
Right.
Now, one of the interpretations is it only violates company law. But when we come to fixing director's remuneration, we take help of company law, Section 349, allows us to make that much payment.
Yeah, please complete, sir.
So while computing interest amount, we can also take recourse to section 372 capital A.
Right.
Now, if you see the new Companies Act, now it says that the directors have to certify that the transactions are at arm's length. And if they fail and give the wrong certificate, then there is now penal and your criminal.
Sure.
So any transaction now, the things are gone past now. You can extend interest-free loans, etc. But now under the Companies Act also, you have to compute the arm's length. But there is no arm's length principle as such.
Yeah, that's an interesting.
Plus, another thing is that in new Companies Act, now this limit will be applicable even to the subsidiary companies.
Sure.
Earlier there was no limit for lending it to the by holding company to a subsidiary company. And even in case of private company, 372 was not available. Everything is coming under the full law.
Right. So this new company law is a very interesting dimension, and new company law as well as domestic TP sort of both have come luckily or otherwise around the same time. Manisha, you know, you've been talking to a lot of corporates and impact of new company law. How new company law is sort of impacting the domestic TP? I guess even international TP to a certain extent.
Right, because now under the new company's law, in terms of any transactions with related party, if you know they are in the ordinary course of the business and they are not at arm's length, or they are not in the ordinary course of business, these two conditions are there, you will have to ensure that it is at arm's length. And for arm's length, they will rely on the transfer pricing principles. And the definition of related party under the company's bill or act, which has been the New Companies Act, is now much wider than perhaps even a 40A2B.
And then you have AS18 also. Absolutely. Related party transactions.
Right.
Also on certain transactions which are covered. So we are talking about capital, but now, you know, one of the transactions which is covered is the sale, purchase or disposal of any property of any kind. So that is clearly covered now under company's law. So now, you know, whether it is capital expenditures covered or not,
right,
or sale is covered or not in terms of property, you know, one will also have to look at it from, or rather have to comply at least from a company law perspective.
Right. Ms. Mehta, you know, on this new company law, it again impacts, I'm sure, a lot of companies in your group. What is a sort of process that you've put in place so that the secretarial, finance, tax work together, and especially from a domestic TP point of view, anything different that you've done in this year to address domestic TP as well?
First of all, the related party which is required in the Companies Act is entirely different than what I require for the domestic transfer pricing. No?
Right.
So the tax team, they set with the company secretary, you know, to that what you give me the list as per Companies Act, what are the related party transaction needs to be disclosed in the balance sheet and what it is. So the complete list was made, you know, that what is a related party, this thing's names, list, which is required as per the STO, you know. So that thing plus another thing which has been done after this new Companies Act has come, the group has gathered and they have found out that where are the variations, where the any grandfathering is there and where the rules act which are not applicable now needs to be applicable. So what are the steps when it is to be taken?
Right. Samir bhai, you know, one interesting point that comes out of this is, of course, company law is new. November 30th deadline, and I'm sure all of us as professionals will ensure that 3CV gets filed before 30th November, come what may. But I think larger question is that in the next coming months, years, how corporates should proactively look at domestic TP seriously. So I remember on international TP, you know, benchmarking was one of the approaches that was considered, or corporates actually put in place robust processes when the transaction is entered into. You know, what's your experience while discussing with clients? How are they looking at it from a future perspective?
Right, Aman, I think there is more realization now after say amendment in Companies Act 2013 or the new Companies Act 2013 that now transfer pricing is not just a compliance issue, it's not just a tax issue, it has gone to a board level. It's already gone, but earlier because of TP adjustment, now because of corporate governance. And right. That's a big shift, I think, from a tax compliance or tax angle to a corporate governance issue. And I think going forward, I feel also discussing with clients that there will be more focus, attention on this, not to get like getting ready after year gets over. In fact, it will be a real contemporaneous activities which will be required to be done.
Right.
So they will be more prepared, as you say, to set the process in place rather than, you know, wait and kind of, if I put it with respect to all of us here, not a post-mortem, you know, after things has happened and we tried many times to fit in.
Right.
Something which sometimes very forcefully.
Right. We have another five or 7 minutes before we end the panel, but before we move on, are there any questions from anybody in the audience for the panel? Yes, Purnima.
Yeah, my question is actually in conjunction with the company bill, wherein the CSR new provision that has come that the 2% of your net profit needs to be contributed towards that. Now it is also possible that many of the big you know, corporates would actually have the CSR activity already ongoing, wherein they would have their own trust or foundation, and then the director of the company and the trustee of, you know, this foundation are the same persons, yeah, which would actually bring that transaction also under the this particular purview. So what type of implication do you see if that is a situation and the company already has a kind of policy to contribute X amount of money to this foundation when the trustee and the director is the same person?
Mr. Khaitan, now would you like to
see later? This is CSR contributions if you are making to the trust or say, so when I'm just going into the trust now, these are contributions or in say layman's language, it is donation. So there cannot be any arm's length principle for this. I can make a contribution of X amount, I can make contribution of Y amount, and CSR, that is, it is has come as a corporate governance coupled with your social responsibility. So you have to set apart some of the funds. I just give you one example, like in earlier sugar companies, molasses fund were to be set apart. So those kind of things, these were to be set apart against the under an act. So I'm taking cognizance of those decisions, and I'm not going into the naming those decisions. One is that now there is no white paper what is CSR, what will it include. So whether if I make a contribution to my trust and then the trust makes political contributions, whether it or it not political in the sense I say it goes to the some politician and then he lays out those funds for the development of his own area. So whether that kind will be the CSIR, I don't think this is made by the government. So they will come with like this, our commerce minister,
company law minister.
Now he said we will come out with the just a guidance.
Yeah, yeah.
What will be covered under the CSR?
That's the deductibility point. Manisha, would you like to add anything on this question?
I think there is firstly a debate itself, you know, on the trustee who's acting in the fiduciary capacity, whether that itself will be covered under the related party. So I think that first needs to be analyzed itself. And then on this, you know, the payments which are made and which will be claimed as a deductible expenditure, one will have to get back into the facts and circumstances and look and see how one we can get.
Right. Yes, we have a question.
I want to bring out here that the donations that we make, they are not eligible deduction under 28 to 42, 43. They are probably, we claim it under 80G. So still, do you feel the provisions of SDT could be triggered in a donation?
Yes,
I just want to give you, you have just touched the right one chord. It says heading C of chapter 6A.
Okay.
Heading, so it starts 80GG. If you end then six chapter 6, heading C starts with 80HH. So one part is that one view can be taken that this is not covered.
Right. Samir bhai, would you like to add anything?
Yes, see, if you look at the section 92BA subclause 5, speaks of the transactions which are covered under the specified domestic transactions or any transactions referred to in any other section under chapter 6A or section 10A, which is SEZ, to which the provision of subsection 8 or 10 of ATIR are applicable. So, chapter 6A now.
To ATI, ATI, so ATI. I think we may still be able to come out of donation issue. That it's not, even in chapter 6, the ATI 10 or ATI 8 has to be applicable.
Yes.
Okay. So I think donation in that sense may go out of SDT. And I think it's a good case to argue otherwise also, that donation is obviously, as the name suggests, it's like charity or out of, it's not an expenditure. And
right.
I don't think department will, I mean, they are aggressive but won't come. Technically, we are fine. Otherwise, I don't think they will come and say, no, I will deny you ATG because you have made to an interested party. As Manisha said, first we need to define, there is still not clarity. And there is a good argument to say that trustees or trust are not related party. So their trustees, my director is acting as a fiduciary capacity. It's not as a director of that company. So I think trust itself, whether it can be a related party, this can be a good position to say they are not.
Also, I want to specify here is that under section 48OB, we talk of a director and we talk of an entity which has substantial interest in the business. So again, it talks of a director who has substantial interest in the business of an organization. So again, do you feel trust is carrying out a business? So again, a relationship, whether trust can be a 48OB party. That these two observations I just wanted to
right. And Samir bhai, just like to supplement a question, ESOP trust, for example, the transactions with ESOP trust, would they be, for example, subject to domestic TP? Any immediate thoughts on this?
Just on ESOP, and then we'll come to this query also. But ESOP, even if I contribute, but that I don't claim as a deduction, right?
Right.
There are Wipro and some decisions which they have allowed the deduction, but
amortization of ESOP cost is allowed as deduction, but that's not a payment in that sense, perhaps that's one.
The department is still disputing that it's not a payment. And your query, frankly, if trust is, and we have some cases, and we are frankly, we need to take a position where we have some cases where it's strictly not a trust, but it claims from our purpose Section 11 exemption under the income tax, in Section 25 company. And there are transactions with that Section 25 company by this taxpayer. And if we read very strictly, it can get covered, and we are still studying whether your main point, as I was saying, whether trust itself can be said just because directors are common or they are holding, whether it can become as a related party for FOTAT.
I just want to add one thing, that if you are floating, forming any trust for ESOP or SAR, now the thing is that one has to look into the insider trading provisions also. So it is better, and it is the most common practice I'm seeing, that independent, like some bankers, top-notch bankers, they are appointed as the trustee of the trust. Why I'm saying that if you buy the shares or the shares are allotted, you cannot do the purchase and sale transactions within 6 months. So that is the one area where you will not find any senior management from the company sitting as a trustee of the trust.
Okay. Yeah, interesting. Last question, and I'll start with Samir bhai. Based on your interactions with revenue officials over the last 1.5 years, how do you see department is sort of looking at this subject? What do you see, apart from the FAQ or circular which hopefully will give some relief. How do you, what is it that you've seen revenue prepared on this topic? SDT, yeah.
Frankly, Amaya, when we do ask, and first thing they say, we are too now busy with cross-border TP itself. But just on a serious side, they do say that we'll get some idea once we file the first flow of Form 3CV. Then he says we'll know what the work involved, and I think they are still underestimating the work involved.
Right.
We go by the number of Form 3CV will be filed.
Right.
But they say we'll take a call once we get some idea on what's the implications.
Right. Ms. Mehta, your assessment, domestic TP, is it as risky as international TP, if not more?
I would better say that in international TP, they raised the demand of 70,000 crores. This will be another animal by which they will be try to, you know, have innovative ideas, and, you know, I really don't know how they are going to interpret the way. As the law is evolving, let's wait and watch and wish all the best to all of us.
Mr. Khaitan, your thoughts?
I think this...
Are you worried with domestic TP?
I think this... it's not unique to the tax. In our Indian atmosphere and context, everything we take some decision when we are pushed to the wall. And the decisions are taken as knee-jerk decisions without going into any details or thought process. There is no thought process. GlaxoSmithKline came, decision came, and then Supreme Court made some observations. I see with due respect to Supreme Court, that Supreme Court should have examined whether there are enough standards which where you can determine the profits of the tax holidays at arm's length. There were there. What we have done, we have just ticked away from fair market value to arm's length principle. And there is no because there is no guidance on this. There is no paper, no discussion, and in the parliament, in a day, all acts are passed without. So this is the pathetic we are.
Manisha, your advice to clients on how they should be approaching domestic TP?
I think, you know, since the last year, our advice has been to do an impact analysis upfront at the price setting stage itself, because later, you know, when you are doing the documentation of Form 3CV, it's more of testing. So upfront, one should look at it.
Right. This brings us to...
I won't delay, but just Khaitan was saying Supreme Court and following Supreme Court. So when the SDT came and you were discussing with policy makers and we were saying why you brought this and it's not required. And so he says when we reverse Supreme Court decision, that time also you shout that you are reversing Supreme Court. You know, and now when I follow Supreme Court, still you shout. So that is their position. But Manisha said we have to get prepared.
That is true, but there was no one to guide these wise men that there are provisions in the Act. 80A6 was there, 80IA8 was there, 80IB10 was there, 80IA5 was there. All these provisions are there, and on the top of that they are bringing this, and that is in half cooked measure. Now if supposing I decide not to claim, say 10AA, I decide not to claim, I forego that. Then I am out of
SDT. Right. With this note, we come to the end of this panel discussion. I request my partner Arun Giri to propose a vote of thanks. And I thank all my panelists for sharing their thoughts as well.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah, thanks. I think the testimony to the quality of the discussions that we've had today is the fact that most of you all have stayed back and stayed awake. I think that's most important. We've had a great session right from the morning. I think we've gone through all the nuances of the domestic TP law. It's a big elephant in the room. No one knows how it's going to play out, whether ultimately all the fears are going to come true, whether it's going to be another 70,000 crore figure that we are looking at, or it's going to be an unfounded fear. We'll know in a year or so. But thanks so much. Thanks to all the panelists. Thanks Ramesh ji. Thanks Pinky ji, thanks Samir bhai, Manisha, and the entire Deloitte team who worked tirelessly to put this together. A big hand for them, please. I think. Thanks to you all for the patronage, for coming here, and I'll just take 30 seconds to talk about Tax Sutra. You know, for all of you all who've not subscribed to it, by attending this, you all can avail of a 15-day free trial to the portals. You all can send an email to sales@taxsutra.com. All the coordinates are there, and you can be on our mailing list and check out our service. And if you like it, please do subscribe. Look forward to your critical feedback and suggestions, and we will send you an invite about the next event soon. Thank you so much for it.